This is a National Arts Center podcast.
After many years of running a company, I thought everybody questions things. It can't just be me. Artistic leadership comes with a price, so let me give you some stage advice. Today I'm very pleased to introduce an AD of 2B from the land of moose and spruce. Mr. Christian Barry is here to talk about leadership while he's directing Old Stock.
Hi, my name is Jillian Kiley. I'm the Artistic Director of English Theatre here at the National Arts Centre, and I'm very pleased to welcome you to Stage Advice, Artistic Directors Talk About the Dramas That Keep Them Up at Night. And we're going to be having some guest artistic directors and directors into the show to talk about some of the issues that come up for us, because it turns out they're pretty interesting issues, I think. And we are very solitary, lone wolves, you know, usually in the rehearsal room. There's only one director or one artistic director in a company, usually. Hey, Christian. And usually we're alone a lot, and we run into a lot of the same ethical, moral issues and artistic issues too, and leadership issues. So I thought we should have a little exchange about that. So I'd like to welcome our first guest, Christian Barry. Christian Barry is an award-winning director and theater maker from Halifax, Nova Scotia. He's the artistic co-director of 2B Theatre. His productions have toured to prestigious festivals and theaters around the world. This is true. Last year, Christian was nominated for 4 individual Drama Desk Awards. That's in New York, including Best Director, and received a nomination for Best Production. As of today, he is also a finalist for the 2019 Siminovich Prize for Directing here in Canada. Christian is here at the National Arts Centre tonight, opening his brilliant work, Old Stock, A Refugee Love Story. Welcome, Christian.
Thank you, Jillian.
Okay, so 5-star and flop.
Okay.
Where in which directors rate the decisions they make.
Okay. The first one is really like an artistic director flop. Okay. It's not a director flop. It's an artistic director flop. I had an interview in Halifax at the CBC last week. And we'd put out this press release because we have a show opening there soon. We want to sell some tickets to it.
Yeah.
And so I was kind of like shy and Canadian and humble about the Siminovich nomination. But I realized, I said to my staff, guys, this is a chance for a press release. Mm-hmm. We can get this out there and it'll probably get some uptake, and maybe it'll sell some tickets to the Halifax run of Old Stock. So we did the unhumble thing and sent out a press release saying that I was a finalist for this award, and they invited me on. And then when I got on the air, I did the humble thing. And she said to me at one point, she put the ball right on the tee. She said, "So, Old Stock has won all kinds of awards. Tell me about that." And, you know, that's why I was there, was to that.
Yeah.
And I said something like, "Yeah, it's going really great. I mean, people really seem to like it. Like, it connects with people, and you know, it's kind of funny, and there's music in it, and it's great." And I left it there. I didn't answer her question. She had asked me to brag about all the awards that we had won.
Yeah.
And I could have said, "Yeah, it's a great show. It's a New York Times critics pick. We had 6 Drama Desk Awards. I've never been so honored to lose 6 awards in my life. It won the Nova Scotia Masterworks Prize, the highest honor for the arts in Nova Scotia." I didn't say any of that.
Yeah.
So the 150,000 people, huge hit Edinburgh. We got awards in Edinburgh. All these awards, I could have, and you know, we won a bunch of local awards at the Merit Awards in Halifax, and I could have said all of that to the, I don't know, 150,000 people who listen to CBC in the mornings in Halifax, and I didn't say any of it. And it was a flop.
Let's talk briefly while you're on that.
Yeah.
I'm going to take a note because I want to hear about your 5-star. But I'd love to talk to you about shame, because I think shame is a really, we've spoken about shame before. and I think shame is a really interesting problem for directors or for any artist, actually. It's not even directors. We know an artist who is, you know, whenever they expose their talent, they feel that they've exposed themselves, and then they're very, very deeply ashamed. And you'll see that happen with some actors.
Yeah.
They go out, they do this masterful performance, and then they're so deeply ashamed afterwards, and they're begging you for notes and criticisms because they just need to be beaten down because they're so ashamed of what they've done. And you know, I personally go through a lot of shame whenever I do something that asks for me to do something where I am showing off a bit. And then we have other artists and performers who are very comfortable with being open, and you know, they don't feel that shame. So we'll talk about that in a second. I would love to catch up with you about your five-star.
Five-star.
I'm sorry to ask for five-star. Find another name for it.
Yeah, no, that's okay. I get it. You know, as an artistic director, I get it. You got to repost the five stars. As a director, I think that's a split in my personality there. The director hates the five stars. The artistic director sees the value. Yeah. I think it's. I'll go for the year envelope for that one. I think it's choosing good collaborators. Mm. I just think I feel like that's. The projects that work, the ones that really go, are the ones where I'm excited to go to work with the people I'm working with.
Yeah.
So I just feel like, so Old Stock, I guess, and that's more than a year, but I'll talk about those collaborators just because that's the show that we're doing here. Yeah, it's like, I knew when people have often asked, did you think it would be a big hit? Do you think this show would take off? Because, you know, we've done 200 and almost 20 performances of it now all around the world, and it's been amazing. I never would have expected it would go as well as it's gone, but I really did have confidence in it. And the reason I did, I knew it was a good idea, but I was working with Hannah Moscovich and Ben Kaplan, and they're both, they're monsters. They're incredible. They're theater performance monsters. Hannah's a genius, and Ben is utterly unique and powerful in a room. And I just knew that we had the right chemistry to make something awesome. It's the thing. The five-star thing is picking good collaborators, and I feel like I've had a run of success doing that right.
Thank you. You know, Anne Bogart talks about the eroticism of rehearsal, which is always, you know, a kind of dangerous thing to talk about, but I believe it's true, actually, and I think great artists and great directors will recognize that, and it's not about, and I hope I'm quoting her right, but I always was very inspired by that thought that she had, that you go and there's an energy between you that you want to consummate's not the right word, but it's because we're in the language of eroticism, but you go to work because the people there make you buzz, they make you
vibrate, and so
I think audiences can feel that, and then there's nothing as painful. Oh my gosh, what was I talking to a designer recently who was like, I think it was Beth Cates. She was saying, you know, there's nothing as hard as going to work with people who don't excite you.
Yeah.
Because you're not excited, because you know you're a good designer, or you know you're a good director or whatever, but there's no ideas coming because there's no, it's so much about collaboration.
Who was she talking about?
Some Halifax company. Okay, let's. I want to follow up on shame because tell me a little bit about shame.
Well, I don't know. I mean,
shame as an artist. Like, why humble? Would it serve us? You know, I'm hoping this broadcast will speak to artistic directors and directors, not just from Canada, but all over. You said, you know, why did the Canadian thing? But what? You know, does humility serve? Should, you know, who wrote the book? Chris Talley, the director who wrote Does Play Me, the podcast Play Me.
Yeah.
Wonderful director and wonderful man. And he and I wrote a musical one time that had the line, who wrote the book on Peter Brook? Peter Brook did. So it's just, it's about who is brave enough to be bold.
Yeah. It's a hard one for me to answer. Like, so, you know, my instinct is that shame is really valuable and important. And I know that we're sort of talking about it in the context of, like, being bold. But, like, I guess I think that, you know, the instinct to be introspective and really think about whether what you just did or said was the right thing is a valuable thing. I guess I think that hopefully you've done a lot of that introspection in advance in your prep work for whatever it is, so that then you can feel okay standing there and being vulnerable and just knowing that you can be present because you've done enough searching caressing your inner shame around whatever it is you're talking about, you know, so that you can reveal that in a way that that isn't paralyzing. Because I guess that's the thing we're talking about. We're talking about not being paralyzed by it, I guess. Mm-hmm. Like, I feel like after that CBC interview, it wasn't too bad. I spent the morning, though. I really did spend half the morning. I think it was probably after the second coffee of the day at, like, 2 p.m. or something, where I was like, okay, forget about that now. We're done with beating yourself up about that. There'll be other interviews and other podcasts, and you'll remember not to do that, and you'll learn from it.
Right.
So I guess it's those two things. One is, like, your instinct about shame is probably a good barometer for something that you need to grapple with or think more deeply about. And then the other thing is about it is it's probably a good teaching tool that you can learn not to do that again, I think I have a complicated relationship with it. I mean,
do you ever boast? Like, if you could ever boast, it would be about old stock. Like, do you ever boast about old stock? Even your
No. I was about to say I've sort of talked myself into it when I'm doing those donor speeches or something like that. I'm okay with reading out the accolades, but, you know, I think it's always my instinct to then talk about how good my collaborators are. You know what I mean? Like, to try and sort of be like, we've won, and of course we've won, because my wife, Hannah Moskovich, is really brilliant.
So, you know, it's about turning the league.
Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. Yeah, you know, that kind of is the thing. And that's what's funny, I guess, in some ways about this is, like, I think when we do, you know, press interviews, that's probably my trick a lot of the time, is like, I'm still being a director. I'm still directing the focus over there. Look at the people on stage. They're the ones on stage. Aren't they great? Aren't they funny? Aren't they sexy? Isn't this fun? But I don't ever feel like I'm trying to tell people how good a job I did. It doesn't come naturally. Yeah.
What's the best show you've ever seen, or the best show you saw this year? And what would you have done to make it better? It's funny. It's a funny question. I wonder if, you know, because we're always so afraid that we're going to hurt the feelings of the other artists.
I'm not afraid of hurting Ivo van Hoff's feelings. I did see that, his production of A View from
a Bridge,
Bridge in or New York. And the moment that, I'm not sure. Mm-hmm. The moment that I think everyone says, oh, this is genius, is the moment when all this red liquid starts falling from the heavens. Like, it rains blood in this moment. But I was loving every minute of that production, and when that happened, it was totally underwhelming. It was actually, the idea was brilliant, but something about the stagecraft of it was, well, you just opened a trap above them and a bunch of water fell out, and if you had done it in a way that demanded a little bit more from my imagination, I think I would have been pulled more deeply into his sorrow in that moment. Because he had said something like this, you know, in his interviews about it, that it was all about doing as little as you could. Like, they had all the props in the next room. I remember reading that they had them available, but they tried to not use them if they didn't need to. And so it was an empty, spare stage, and I love that. I love minimalism when you're, again, thinking about Thornton Wilder and Our Town, when you're drawn into the physical experience. I just feel like it creates a deeper communion and a deeper intimacy, and he did it the whole way through. And then when this rain thing happened, I kind of thought, I just don't think you needed it.
I feel like this is a good opportunity to just talk or remind audiences who may have seen it or experienced it of Christian's brilliant, brilliant production, which was the production that made him break through on the scene, I think, of Thornton Wilder's Our Town, that he did called Revisited.
Yeah.
And the audience sat around a table while the story was retold by audience sitting at the table. And it was a moment of communion and magic that I will never forget.
Oh, thank you.
We are at, I think, the meat of the conversation.
Good, we got through the bread.
We're at the meat. We're at the meat of the conversation, and that is the director's dilemma. Every day we have one, and this week we had one in particular that came up this week. So I kind of have two for you. One that's very, very timely that, you know, I just love your opinion on and your advice on for this director's dilemma, in which artistic directors solve other artistic directors' problems without judgment.
Solve, okay, I'll try.
And without judgment. That's the thing. I've gone to other artistic artistic directors or directors in the past and gone, oh, you know, I had this problem, like, you know, I had this person cast and then there was somebody else who thought they were cast because there was a mix-up with the wardrobe people thought that they had costumed the wrong person, you know, in a larger organization. And as I don't even know. And the other artistic director went, you did what? Why didn't you check? What was wrong with you? Why did you make such a stupid mistake? I was like, oh, my God, help
maybe
me.
Maybe all you wanted was a little sympathy
I just
and
need
someone
some
to listen.
And, like, just tell me what to do because I don't know what to do because I need to save my relationship with both of these actors. Anyway, so first of all, there was in Canada, we have the Baroness von Sketch Show, which is a brilliant, brilliant satire, but really it's actually not even satire. It's just real life. Crystallized by these five brilliant women. Four brilliant women. There are four of them, but there are other women on the show who are also brilliant.
That's right.
Called that. Really, really brilliant people. And they did a sketch this week about the land acknowledgement, which we have been doing here at the NEC and right across Canada. There was kind of agreement that all theaters, before every show, acknowledge the traditional Indigenous territories that they're on. But this has been a kind of like undercurrent, you know, that there's always been like kind of discomfort about it. Some members of the Indigenous community don't feel comfortable with it because they say, well, okay, so you say that you're on our land. Well, what are you going to do about it? And I was quite taken and disturbed by this sketch in which they say that. So I was trying to find a way because, of course, we have an Indigenous theater department here at the NEC. So it's not, you know, it's not empty for us to acknowledge the land that we're on, but it's still kind of empty. So or can be perceived as empty. So, you know, even now in this heart to heart podcast where I'm hoping artistic directors and directors are listening, you know, I'm still cautious about how I speak about this because it's such dangerous territory for all of us. Who are artistic directors, unless you're an Indigenous person in Canada or on Turtle Island. So, Christian, help me out. What am I going to do about the land acknowledgements now that of Canada is laughing at people who do land acknowledgements?
Now that they know we're all hypocrites.
Now that they know.
Well, first of all, I almost did in the bio jump in and say I'm from beautiful Chibuktuk in Mi'kma'ki, which is the Mi'kmaq words for Halifax, Nova Scotia. And yeah, it's hard. I don't think I have an answer because I do think like reconciliation, we're barely at the truth stage of truth and reconciliation. Mm-hmm. In fact, we're not there yet, are we? As a group. And I think, to be honest with you, that's kind of at least what land acknowledgements are trying to kick off is some acknowledgement that we're in process, that we're trying to do something about it. And I'm always thinking about action when I'm doing it. Every time I sort of, let's say, recraft it, rewrite it, I'm trying to think, is there an action this week that I feel like I can I can either take or propose or somehow evoke in what I'm saying? I think actually when the heritage and, you know, when Heritage didn't fund the NAC Indigenous theater here. How long ago was that? Like a year ago, 6 months ago? At one of our speeches, we mentioned that as a possible action that people could take. Because here we were in the theater and, you know, you're thanking all the sponsors and all that stuff. And we said, oh yeah, and there's a really important initiative happening at the National Arts Center that just didn't get its funding. So maybe you want to check that out. And if you have a way to support that, please do. I said to you the other day that I'm currently like shocked and flabbergasted and frustrated, and it goes beyond frustrated. I'm kind of devastated that the government of Canada decided to not honor the decision of the tribunal to give a settlement to the children from the 60s scoop. And so what I've been thinking is next time I get up on stage, I can maybe at least include some mention of some way that people might be able to take action or engage with that subject. But anyway, because that's a personal thing for me. I don't know if I'll do it. I don't know if I'll have the guts to do it. I don't know if it will feel political or if it will feel like I'm saying it for the wrong reasons, you know, because it's the other thing you wonder about. Does it feel like you're grandstanding or something? Mm-hmm. And so
it goes back to shame.
Yeah, it goes back to shame. And so I don't know, but I guess all I've been saying to myself is re-engage with it honestly every time you do it, and try and not just acknowledge something about place and time and where we're at, but maybe find a way to engage with it authentically so that it doesn't turn into something that you just do by rote.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know. I mean, what do you think about what I just said?
Well, you know, Christian was there the other day, and don't say a word. Let's talk about shame for a second. So the other day I introduced the preview of Old Stock, and I was taking this on. I was like, you know, because I'd heard undercurrents from Indigenous friends, and, you know, that people are, you know, and there's an article that's out where there's three different Indigenous perspectives about the land acknowledgement. You know, one person says, absolutely still do them. Another person says, I don't really care. And the third person's like, you absolutely shouldn't be doing them. Like, unless you're actually returning us the lands, you know, or paying rent to us directly.
Yeah.
Don't talk about it because, or don't talk about it, but don't talk about, like, you're grateful. Like, well, I don't care if you're grateful, you know.
Yeah.
So, and I actually really understand that perspective. And it is it's a very difficult thing because, you know, you're... Mm. So anyway, the other day in front of an audience of Christians, people who bought tickets to come and see this preview the other day, I not really improvised, but I kind of declared that I'm going to continue saying that. I mean, I don't even know what I was doing, and I never didn't intend to do it. I was just trying to, it was stupid. Anyway, so I was talking about my flop last week, and I said... to the audience, you know, I think I'm going to I'm going to continue to do land acknowledgements. Like, I'd say, you know, as a couple of friends, because I was really upset about it after I'd done it, a couple of friends in the audience were like, Jill, nobody saw that Baroness von Sketch show. I was like, it was viral. But it's, you know, it's viral in my community,
bubble,
right?
Yeah.
In our bubble. And so I said, you know, anyway, I said in front of this audience, you know, the Old Stock was written because it was inspired by Stephen Harper, who, you know, said Old Stock Canadians as opposed to refugee Canadians. And I'd like to just say we're all new stock Canadians, you know, because we're not Indigenous people. And and now here's my opportunity to talk to you about Indigenous communities in Canada, and that we are on the land. We're gathered here today on the land of the, you know, Algonquin people and the unceded territory. And I kind of like went off on this thing. And of course, as soon as I brought up Stephen Harper, Prime Minister Stephen Harper's name, you know, somebody hissed in the audience. We're in the middle of an election right now. I'm not sure when this is going to play, but we're in the middle of an election. It just got super tense. And I'm introducing this beautiful show. And so, you know, it felt like I was up there for hours. Tell me it wasn't that long anyway. But anyway.
It wasn't that long.
It wasn't that long. But I felt like I was up there for hours. And it was like this huge thing that I made this big political wayward political statement, and then kind of went, enjoy the show. Enjoy the show. And then took off. And then, you know, Ben comes on in Old Stock. Ben comes out with this big, you know, gorgeous big song to start the thing. And the audience is like back in their seats. They're not, you know, they've already been assaulted by my political statement to start the show.
It's a political show. It's a political medium. It was great. Your candor was wonderful and inspiring. I really appreciated it. I'm not kidding.
I won't do it again.
I guess one of the things I wonder, and this is sort of an emergent thought, but like, I am working on shows that now contain some version of a land acknowledgement within the show.
Uh-huh.
And because I was actually thinking about it when I was saying what we do is inherently political. It is, right? And we're always talking, we're trying to address the current moment with what we do, whether it's Shakespeare or whether it's MacIver, you know, it's the current moment. So I wonder if that's part of the evolution of where we're headed, that we'll actually be able to get to a place where something nuanced and complex can be included in it. You know, I'm not saying that we all need to have that well, in fact, I guess I am. I'm saying exactly that we don't need to have the rote text of, you know, the unceded territory of the Algonquin Nation, but that rather somehow some of the struggles that we're engaging with can be somehow contained in it. And maybe it won't always fit, but I guess that's, I'm wondering if we're evolving to a place where we can include it in the work in some way. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
That it doesn't have to be a, because I thought about that when you said it, like the better way to get people to engage with the question would be to make it a good part of good art.
Okay, this here is a director's dilemma. This was brought forth not by me, but by another director who came to me for advice. So I'm going to make that public without using that person's name or circumstance. So we're inviting audience members to please send us in your daily dilemma. And I'll give you the contact information at the end of the show. But I hope you will send in your daily dilemma, and I will ask these wonderful directors that I bring into the show to answer your dilemma for you. So you are a great person to answer this question. Imagine that as a director, you've been collaborating with another artist for a long time. Suddenly, that artist is very specifically shot to stardom. Now, interviews that you used to do together, journalists are only asking for the other artist. Critical reviews have started naming the production after that artist. For example, Lepage's 887. But it would be a collaboration. And you know it's a collaboration.
Yeah. But I got dropped out of it.
You got dropped out of it. People are, you know, calling only the writer's name or only whatever.
Yeah.
You see yourself as the lead on the project. Mm. How do you manage that personally and professionally? And you're the artistic co-director, so you do this in every way.
I'm trying to hold myself to task on this because my gut is saying that I'd be fine with it. Isn't that great? Pay no attention to that man behind the curtain. I'm trying to make the collaborators that I'm working with the stars. But if it's like, you know, as extreme as it is in the question, and I've literally kind of been pushed aside, I think it's true. There would be some part of me that would, you know, be hurt and fight for some kind of recognition. I think I'd probably talk to my collaborator.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's what I'd do and say, honestly, I'm feeling hurt or, you know, underappreciated, and I know that they're going to love you because you're brilliant and I want them to. Maybe you can help me. You know what I mean? Maybe there's a way that Lepage, when he does the interview, will say also thanks to my good friend. But that's the other thing. I'm sort of like, if your collaborator isn't doing that, aren't they a bit of a dick? Like, don't they see that? And shouldn't they share this? I don't know. Now I'm dying to know what the real situation was. And it's like, I don't know. I guess maybe don't work with that dick again.
Yeah, that could be it.
But like, I think that would be the thing. It would be to be honest about it. I mean, like, God, we could probably do a whole nother podcast on like the directors who play games. Like I really hope that I've never done that thing of like manipulating a performer by some kind of end around. Mm-hmm. And like, I really try and be honest. I mean, I guess sometimes, you know, you have to find the right way to be honest, so you're going to choose your words carefully. But I try really hard to be honest with my collaborators. Like, I don't know how else to be. I can't sit in a room with someone and go to the intimate, exposed, vulnerable places I want to go to if I'm not willing to be honest with them about my feelings. They won't be honest with me if I'm not honest with them, I think. So anyway, that would be my, I don't know if that's a useful tool in this situation, but that would be my suggestion, would be find a way to be honest with the collaborator. Because I don't think there's any way to sort of grandstand your way back into the picture. That's not,
right.
I wouldn't think that would charm anybody.
Yeah. But tell me about your co-lighting, co-existence with your designers.
Like, so I think my answer to your question is life's too short. Mm-hmm. Share credit. I don't know.
Just share it.
Like, and also, if you're good at what you do and you're authentic about it, the pattern's going to repeat itself. Like, you know what I mean? This thing about
and the people who need to know will find out that you're the director.
You think?
Yeah.
Don't you think? Like, and that this idea that a show takes off and is a big hit, I guess, if it really takes off, but I don't know, there'll be other shows. I guess I think... So, yeah. So, to answer your question with Old Stock, Louisa and I, Louisa Adamson, who's Tubi's director of production, and she's the stage manager for this show, but we also co-designed the lights, and we co-designed the set. And Old Stock, a refugee love story, was created by Hannah Moscovich, Ben Kaplan, and Christian Barry. And I think, in all cases, we honestly assessed it and went, whose idea was this and who executed it and how do we share that? And in all cases, we said, yeah, we all did it.
We all did it, right?
Yeah, it's too messy.
And once you get into, do you feel that once you get into, well, that's mine and this is mine, that you're lost?
Yeah. So just, and if you're with smart, sensitive people, you know, just agree that you shared it and share. Sharing's better. Sharing is caring. It's no, but I kind of think that it's true. Like, life's too short. Like, I don't know. It's the work is what's important. Credit, great. I guess we all got to pay the bills, and you want your resume to look good, and you know you want to be successful. But just be authentic and compassionate. Mm-hmm. You know, and respectful, and
sometimes it's the. Assistant director, hey, who, like, that's an interesting relationship. Yeah. When an assistant director is so valuable, they actually add a huge amount to the production, and yet you as the director, or if there's an assistant director listening, you know, assistant directors would be like, that was my idea.
Yeah.
You know, the artistic director is getting all the credit for it. How do you take that? Do you just kind of zen out and go, well, that's part of the learning? Because, you know, in the credit, like in the reviews, people aren't going to credit artistic assistant directors.
It's true. You know? Yeah, I don't know.
Though they should sometimes, because in a lot of shows, my experience, that assistant directors are invaluable.
Yeah.
Not invaluable.
Yeah.
Invaluable. Speaking of assistant directors, I'm going to pull a question for you out of the assistant director, associate director question bag.
Okay.
Hi there. My name is Brendan McMurtry Howlett, and I was one of the intern directors at the Shaw Festival. And I want to know, what does your first day of rehearsals look like?
My first day of rehearsal is different every single time. And I kind of panic about it every single time. I actually feel like I have very few, I have more end of rehearsal rituals. I have more tools that I lean on when I'm leaving and saying goodbye and talking about how, you know, I am not the parent of this child. I'm just the pediatrician. I'm just the obstetrician who's helping with the birth, or the midwife who's helping with the birth, and now it's yours. And, you know, I have things at the end of the process. At the beginning, I feel like everything I do is so different that I always ask myself, what's the right ritual component to the first day? What are the right pragmatic components? Because, you know, I've done things where, like, I remember one time, I think this worked. I was doing a farce, directing a farce at Festival Antigonish. And it was a really complicated farce, one of those ones where, you know, the comedy comes from it running beyond your ability to keep up with it, and slamming doors and dropping props and things like
Noises
that.
Noises off, Fado?
Oh, no, it was, I think it was called...
Boing Boing?
No, I think but it was by, oh, God, I'm going to get his name.
Never mind, sir.
Edit this in. It's called Money Money, and it's by Funny Money. It's called Funny Money. I can't remember the guy's name. A British farce guy. And a great British farce guy.
Yeah.
And on day one of rehearsal, we did a run through, because it felt like I wanted them to experience that thing of, I'm not ready, and it's going to run out of control, and it's going to be hard and difficult, and, you know, and I think that worked. Like, I think there was something in the air of that first chaotic run through that I was like, okay, hang on to some of that. But other times I won't do that at all. You know, I'll sit down and we'll talk about what underpins things. So I feel like the only general way I can answer the question about what does day one look like is, it looks like what it should look like for the show we're making. I try really hard to think about the ritual component, the way we're going to set up the room or the table. And I try to think pragmatically about what's going to serve the actors in the process.
Nice. That's a great answer. Okay, a director prepares, in which ADs offer recommendations about how to run your business and your life. I need two recommendations for you, from you. I need two recommendations from you. One that tells us a recommendation you have for a lifestyle choice, and one that is a recommendation for your rehearsal room and or your business, your company.
Oh my gosh. Business. Okay. So, company.
Yes.
We have started doing a thing at 2B Theater Company. This is a very specific practice, and I love it. It's called Roses and Thorns. And we have a regularly scheduled Roses and Thorns meeting. I think it's every 2 weeks. I'd have to look at my iCal. But whenever it comes up, wherever we are in the world, mm-hmm. we all get on some device, or ideally we're all in the same room together, and we talk about a rose in our current life and a thorn in our current life. And we also take an opportunity to ask for help on mm-hmm. something. Those mm-hmm. are the three components of it. And it's meant to be an emotionally based thing. It's meant to talk about your feelings about things. So that rose and thorn are, I'm feeling great about this and I'm feeling thorny about this, mm-hmm. you know. And I'd like some help with this. Oh. And I feel like it has humanized what can be an otherwise panicked, rushed, just keeping up with the to-do list thing.
Yeah.
You know, you can. It's so easy to slide into that, and it's been a wonderful, welcome addition to the human element of our organization.
Is this something you guys made up, or?
No, I think we appropriated it from somebody else, and I don't even know where. It came up at our annual retreat. Huh. We did an annual retreat, which is kind of like the big version of that.
Yeah.
We do an annual retreat on the South Shore of Nova Scotia. It's beautiful. Do that if you can do that, too.
Yeah, yeah.
Someone on staff brought it up, and now we do it, and I love it.
It's great.
Yeah.
And so nothing festers because...
Yeah. The thorn. Or it might, but it helps. It lets the steam off a little, you know?
Yeah. That's great.
Yeah. And
that's
you just connect with everybody as a human a little bit. You just kind of are reminded of everyone's emotional experience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Very wise. And for life.
Yeah.
You have some very special toothpicks,
I have toothpicks, yeah. You want me to tell them about the toothpicks?
Yes.
So these, in my pocket here, I have... a little box of tea tree chewing sticks. Maybe the Thursday Plantation could be a sponsor of the podcast by the Thursday Plantation, Australia's original. So here, I'll give you one too. Would you like one?
Yeah.
So these toothpicks, they're called chewing sticks. They're renewable birch wood.
So good.
With tea tree oil in them. And I like them for a couple reasons. You can use them to clean your teeth, like you get the food out of your teeth. They taste wonderful. And they have this like... like sometimes you hit little pockets of like tea tree oil and the kind of give you like this little rush of excitement in your mouth, mm-hmm. but they really make your breath smell good in a way that gum just never does. They can actually cut through garlic, these things, and they're great. I said to you the other day, I don't bite my fingernails off in the theater when I have one of these while I'm in a tech rehearsal.
And you feel super cool.
Pro tip though.
Pro tip?
If you've got one in your mouth and someone comes in for a kiss, you got to be quick.
Wow. That was super. Yeah.
For the listeners, I just, you know, quickly turned it into the mouth and didn't poke the person in the cheek.
Wow, and you didn't stab yourself in the tongue. Pretty impressive. Okay. That was my first stage advice. Artistic directors talk about the drama that keeps them awake at night. Thank you so much for joining us, Christian. Can you tell us right before we go, what's next for you in your artistic life or your business life?
Sure. I'm going to go home on Saturday, tomorrow. I'm going to go home, and then Old Stalker Refugee Love Story is going to come home. I know what's next. And then Anthony and I are going to get to work. So Anthony Black is my artistic co-director at 2B Theater Company, and he and I are working on our 20th anniversary show.
Mm-hmm.
And we've been kind of jokingly, or we'll see if it's a joke or not, calling the show title To Be Determined, because we don't really have a title yet, and maybe it's going to stay that way. But it's a show about us, how we met and why we met and why we do what we do and how we do what we do. And it's about the fact that we've been doing it for 20 years now. So we're going to get our guitars out finally and get up on stage and sing some maritime songs and tell some stories and try and make a good play.
Beautiful, beautiful. Okay, thank you very much. So Stage Advice was originally dreamed up by Brendan McMurtry Howlett and Kate Smith. Music is by Don Ellis. It's been recorded in the National Arts Center's Hexagon Studio. Find us online at nacpodcasts.ca. We welcome your comments, director's dilemmas, please, and student director questions, preferably in an audio file format. Please write to us at nacpodcasts, all one word, at gmail.com. Thanks, Ryan.